Thank you, Marjorie. I'd like to welcome everyone here this morning. And as the rest of the people are finding their seats, maybe those of us already in here can stand up and greet those around you, especially if we have guests. This time I'd like to have a few announcements. The first one is a reminder that on Thursday, April 18th, between 11 a.m. and 8 p.m., the Stations of the Cross will be set up here at church, and everyone is welcome to stop in as their schedules permit on that day. Are there other announcements this morning?
Hi. Last week, I put some volunteer requests in everyone's mailbox for VBS, and they have incorrect dates on them, so I got a little happy with my copy and paste. But the dates in the bulletin are correct, July 28th to August 1st, and this week I put new volunteer request sheets in your boxes, and they're bright orange, so those are the correct dates. Thanks.
Thanks, Nikki. Any other announcements?
Good morning, everyone. I have a lot of people to thank. Well, let's back up a little bit. I've had a lot of medical problems, so has this young lady, and we're working through it. But I have God to thank for letting me stay here with her. And there's a lot of people that, when we moved here 25 years ago, or came to the church, we found a lot of people here that was really super people. And you still are. And we've enjoyed it a great deal. You have come to us through cards, letters, telephone calls, visits to the hospital, visits to the house, and we really appreciate you more than you could imagine. And I thank you very much, and I thank this young lady for taking care of me the way she does.
Any others?
Good morning. I have an announcement from the search committee, a couple of updates that we wanted to give you. One is that we are now at the point of beginning to look at possible candidates for the part-time associate pastor position. And so if you have anyone that you would like to suggest that the search committee take a look at, now is the time to fill out those forms that we provided a couple of weeks ago and get them to one of the search committee members, because we are moving forward. So Jason Watkins, Carol Schumacher, myself, Connor Headings, Dennis Graber, and Fred Yoder would be the ones that you could give those forms to. The other update is that we have finished a job description for the part-time associate pastor position. This was done in conjunction with Pastor Jared and looking at the results from our 20 pastoral tasks meeting. So that was submitted by the search committee to church council at their last meeting, and they did approve it. So after they approve the minutes during this month's council meeting, it will then be posted on the bulletin board. So anyone who would like to see that job description can see that in a few weeks on the bulletin board. Thank you.
you, Marilyn. Others? At this time, if we could do our Bible memory verse. If you would all say this with me. Offer hospitality to one another without grumbling. Each one should use whatever gift he has received to serve others, faithfully administering God's grace in its various forms. 1 Peter 4, 9 and 10. Today's theme, this fifth Sunday of Lent, is God makes a way through mighty waters, through the wilderness. And I'd like to start by reading a couple of verses from Isaiah 43, specifically verses 16, 18, and 19. This is what the Lord says, He who made a way through the sea, a path through the mighty waters. Forget the former things. Do not dwell on the past. See, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? I am making a way in the wilderness and streams in the wasteland. The reference here is to when Moses was leading the Israelites out of Egypt. As they were leaving, Pharaoh changed his mind and sent his armies after them. And they caught up with the Israelites as they were at the shores of the Red Sea. They had mighty waters in front of them and an army at their backs. They were trapped. They saw death regardless where they turned. They saw no way out. They were going to die. Or were they? God literally made a way through the mighty waters. He parted the sea so they could pass through on dry land. And he kept on leading them through the wilderness beyond. I'm not sure how many of us have faced quite that dire of circumstances where we feel like our life is over no matter where we turn. But each one of us faces our own types of wilderness, or a new term that I coined for this, perhaps our bewilderness. Sometimes life just bewilders us and we're not sure what to do next. Think of those times when you felt lost or overwhelmed, when you've prayed longer and harder and more often than you usually do because you need a path forward and you don't know what it is. I had a couple similar times, 10 years apart, when we needed a path forward. We had started attending Sharon in the fall of 2006, and about 2.5 years later, in the spring of 2009, I was asked to serve on a youth pastor search committee. I agreed, but it felt kind of overwhelming. I'd never done anything like that before, and I was kind of like, I don't know what I'm doing. But we needed God to help us make a way forward for all of us, a way forward for my family. Ruthie was in youth group, and Betty, Christian, and Mondi, our virtual triplets, were going to be starting youth group that fall. And that's probably one of the reasons I was asked, because for the foreseeable future, a sizable percentage of youth group was going to be Schumachers. Prayed a lot. The whole group prayed a lot. God gave us the wisdom we asked for, and we wound up with a new youth pastor, one Jared Chase. Some of you may still know him. And here I find myself 10 years later on a pastor search committee again. This time for a lead pastor. And it's a very familiar name. And we're glad to have Jared moving on into this new position. God is once again starting us on a new path, though with perhaps some familiar scenery. God uses our past to remind us of his faithfulness, giving us hope for his continued leading and faithfulness. But he asks us not to dwell on the past, but rather move forward. I'm excited about the new things that God is going to do among us. I worship and praise my God who leads through the mighty waters, the wilderness, and the bewilderness. At this time, Cliff Troyer will come up and lead us in worship and song.
In the worship book, that would be the blue one. In the worship book, turn to number 544, when we walk with the Lord. Thank you, Denny, for accompanying us today, or Dennis Hall. I would like for us all to stand together. When we walk with the Lord in the light of His Word, what a glory He sheds on our way. While we do His good will, He abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Not a burden we share, not a sorrow we share, but our toil He doth richly repay. Not a grief nor a loss, not a sound nor a cross, but is blessed if we trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. But we never can prove the delights of His love until all on the altar we lay. For the favor He shows and the joy He bestows are for them who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Then in fellowship sweet we will sit at His feet, or we'll walk by His side in the way. What He says we will do, where He sends we will go. Never fear, only trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. And be seated. In the same book, just turn one page. And go to Be Thou My Vision, number 545 in the blue book, the worship book, number 545. I'd like to call your attention to verse 3, and some may not know, Be Thou My Buckler, My Sword for the Fight. There's a reference, of course, to the armor of God, but what the buckler does is he is the one who actually makes the armor, the belt, out of leather, on which are hung basically a skirt, but they're overlapping layers of leather that when a sword from an adversary strikes it, it won't cut through and cut their legs. So that's how come they preferred these skirts instead of pants. And so he's asking the buckler, who is also really provided the word of God, the sword for the fight. And just wanted to call attention to who a buckler really is.
Be Thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. Not be all else to me, save that Thou art. Thou my best thought, by day or by night. Waking or sleeping, Thy presence my life. I ever with thee, and thou with me, Lord. Thou my great Father, and thy child may I be. Waking or sleeping, thy presence doth thee. Be thou my buckler, my sword for the fight. Be thou my dignity, thou my delight. Thou my soul's shelter, thou my high tower. Raise thou me heavenward, O power of my power. Riches I heed not, nor empty praise. Thou my inheritance, now and always. Thou and thou only, first in my heart. Great King of heaven, my treasure thou art. High King of heaven, when victory is won, may I reach heaven's joys, O bright heaven's sun. Heart of my heart, whatever befall, still be my vision, O ruler of all.
I want you also to just simply note that these two songs, as well as the hymn of response, are Jared's choices. Makes the words more poignant.
Our offering this morning is for the general fund. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for each one you've brought here this morning. I thank you for the many ways that you've blessed us. And I pray that you would bless the gifts that we give back to you this morning, and that you would use them to further your kingdom among us. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. And after the offering, then the children will also be collecting the food donations that have been brought.
Still on the
Welcome back. It's week 5, and our focus statement this week is when we are exhausted, God makes a way through the mighty waters. We move forward in hope as God does a new thing. And for scripture, I'll be reading Psalm 126, 2 and 3. Our mouths were filled with laughter, our tongues with songs of joy. Then it was said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us, and we are filled with joy. And Isaiah 43, 20 and 21. The wild animals honor me, the jackals and the owls, because I provide water in the desert and streams in the wasteland to give drink to my people, my chosen people, I have formed for myself, that they may proclaim my praise.
Okay, so today we're talking about how God wants to do new things and how we celebrate. So what's the most exciting thing that has ever happened to you? Can you guys think of a time when you were so happy and excited that you couldn't sit still and couldn't keep quiet? Does anybody have a certain time? What, Silas? When Ohio State won the national championship. Okay, that's, I should have expected that. Well, the Bible tells us that God wants to do new and exciting things in our lives. Things so exciting that the whole world will have trouble sitting still and keeping quiet. Even the plants and animals will want to join in the celebration. When God does this new thing, the Bible says, the wild animals will honor me, the jackals and the ostriches.
Does anybody know what a jackal is? Yeah, it's like a wild dog. So, Cam has a sound for us of what the jackal makes to praise God. All right, so that's how the jackal praises God. So, what about a lion? Can anybody give me an example of how a lion would praise God? Yeah, I heard you all doing it this morning. You didn't do it? Okay. Yes. All right. So now we're going to pray. We do the thing we do when we pray, the hearts. All right. So, O God, you are our God. You have done great things for us, and you want to do new things with us. Thank you for giving us bodies that can move and shout and sing for joy. Amen.
Thank you. Our scripture passage this morning is from Philippians chapter 3. I'll be starting at verse 4b and reading through the end of the chapter. If someone else thinks they have reasons to put confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, in regard to the law, a Pharisee. As for zeal, persecuting the church. As for righteousness based on the law, faultless. But whatever were gains to me, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them garbage, that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ. The righteousness that comes from God on the basis of faith. I want to know Christ, yes, to know the power of his resurrection and participation in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, and so somehow attaining to the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already obtained all this, or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ took hold of me. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining forward toward what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. All of us, then, who are mature should take such a view of things. And if on some point you think differently, that too God will make clear to you. Only let us live up to what we have already attained. Join together in following my example, brothers and sisters, and just as you have us as a model, keep your eyes on those who live as we do. For as I have often told you before, and now tell you again, even with tears, many live as enemies of the cross of Christ. Their destiny is destruction, their God is their stomach, and their glory is in their shame. Their mind is set on earthly things. But our citizenship is in heaven, and we eagerly await a Savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ, who by the power that enables him to bring everything under his control, will transform our lowly bodies so that they will be like his glorious body. And our regional pastor, Cliff Brubaker, will be bringing the message this morning.
Good morning. It's great to be back here at Sharon Mennonite Church with you. It's been a little while since I've had that privilege, and I'm delighted to be here. I have this picture of you all being kind of a spiritually mature congregation, and I just assumed that in being spiritually mature that you wouldn't bring the Ohio State Buckeyes into your worship service. I just assumed that. I'm thinking differently of you. I live in Michigan. We feel good about ourselves because we can offer ourselves a sacrifice to y'all every year. And so we also are licking our wounds after last night's demolishing of the Michigan State football basketball team. But I'm not gonna hold that reference of the Ohio State Buckeyes against anyone here this morning. So I'm especially glad to be here this morning on this occasion, a day like this when we together mark the transition of Jared into a new role, into new responsibilities here at Sharon. As we mark that transition, we celebrate a number of things, I think. The leading of God's Spirit in a variety of ways. The call that originally came to Jared internally and that was affirmed and confirmed by you as a group of believers when you called Jared into ministry, into youth ministry. For the way the Spirit has been working to prepare Jared for this chapter of his life and yours together as a congregation. For the way the Spirit worked with the search committee as it looked at possibilities and called Jared to this change. And for the work that's happened in Jared's life by the Spirit's leading as he that he came to a place where he could and would and did say yes to that call. So it is a day of celebration for us here today. As we all know from what's already been said, this is a season of Lent, and the texts that are given for this particular Sunday of this season seem to be appropriate to me. The one that we just heard seems particularly appropriate to me for this day of celebration for Jared and for you. The passage you just heard is the Apostle Paul writing. Most people who study Paul and what he said and did and wrote, would understand that this is written near the end of Paul's life. He makes several references in the book, and possibly one to being in prison and suffering. Though the main point of this passage is not going to be particularly the one I want to lead us to this morning, which is to think about the makings of a pastor. It certainly does give us that opportunity, if in fact this is Paul writing near the end of his life and reflecting, I think, on taking measurement of what the core motivation for him was. I'd like to start at the end of the... Is there something that... the sound's kind of coming and going. Am I doing okay? Okay, just keep going. All right, so good. Okay. I want to start, if we can, at the end of that little passage, or at least near the end of the passage we just heard. I'm not used to starting at the end and working backwards in a passage, but I want to do that this morning. I hope it makes sense for us. In verse 17, and I really encourage you to keep your Bible out this morning. I'll try and stay fairly close to the text that we had. In verse 17, there's, I think, kind of a remarkable verse. At least for me as a pastor, thinking about a pastor speaking to a congregation that he pastored and that were near and dear to him. And he says, "Join with others in following my example, friends or brothers, and take note of those who live according to the pattern we gave you." It's particularly the first part of that verse that I want to focus on this morning, and where we're going to end up, I hope. I just have to say that when I hear what Paul has to say about this, the weight seems to be pretty large. "Follow my example," he says. My ears ring with a sister passage, also from Paul, also very much like this one, although a bit sharper. In 1 Corinthians 11, the first verse, Paul says, "Follow my example as I follow the example of Christ." I don't believe that I've ever actually said that to anybody as a pastor or as a person, at least in the way that I think Paul says it. But Paul said it, and I think we do well to listen to it. It could be a statement that seems full of someone made by someone who is full of themselves, who is motivated by a sense of self-importance or self-satisfaction or even arrogance. Someone who might be deeply impressed with how they are doing. In fact, it could sound a lot like the people that Paul was taking on as his enemies, or the enemies of the gospel, in this passage. They seem to be quite intent on holding their strict adherence to the law, the Hebrew law, up as an example for everyone else to follow. Do like we do it, y'all. Come after us. Paul seems to use some of that kind of language. My first response to this verse is to strongly suggest to Jared that he not run around telling folks that they should be following his example. And I think I would want to whisper into his ear that pride goeth before a fall. And I think my second response to that verse would be to you as a congregation to say, beware of anyone who would wander around making statements like this. We hear this statement fairly regularly these days, actually, trust me, trust me. I'm always fascinated by this statement because immediately when somebody says to me, trust me, my antenna go up and I say, I wonder if I can trust this person. If this person is trustworthy at all. People who are trustworthy, it seems to me, don't generally have to tell people to trust them. Folks just trust them. People who are worthy leaders don't generally seem to have to tell folks to follow. Good leaders are just the kind of people that folks do want to follow. Leaders don't spend a lot of time telling folks to follow. They just put their energy into leading. So having kind of cast Paul's statement into the shadows a bit, let me ask if there is some other way to hear what Paul says that might be entirely appropriate and in fact good. So let's just say for this morning, for our purposes here, that a mark of a mature pastor, a mark of a pastor who is in fact led and shaped by the Spirit, could easily be to say to others, follow my example. If that person were to do it, it would not be about ego. It would not be about being full of oneself. It would be about something, I think, quite different. So let's hear what Paul has to say before he makes this statement. It's Paul's intention in this passage to wrestle with a key question for early Christians, and in fact, it's a key question in a kind of a different form. The particulars are different. Nevertheless, it's a key question for those of us who live 2,000 years after Paul and who claim to want to follow in the footsteps of Jesus. The question was whether or not a Christian, in order to be justified before God, set right, be right before God, had a God who was righteous and holy. If that person needs to keep the law, the entire Old Testament law. The conflict works itself out in the Gospels often. The Pharisees are regularly in the business of pointing out to Jesus that he wasn't doing a very good job of keeping the law and looking after things. Conflict was also present in the rest of the New Testament, and if one reads the early church, understands, can't help but understand that this was a really critical question. And so it was one that Paul talked about and wrote about often. This is one of the examples of that. Paul has enemies in this setting. I mentioned them a moment ago. He has some really pretty harsh language for them. He calls them mutilators of the flesh. He calls them dogs. They seem to be in the business of advocating for keeping the law in its fullness as the way of making oneself right before God. So let's see what Paul has to say, looking over his shoulder and wondering, what can this tell us about the making of a pastor? Verse 4. Paul says, and this has a note of arrogance, if you want to hear it that way. Paul says, thinking about his enemies and the business they're in over there and how they are successfully keeping the law well and should be models for folks. Paul says, if anyone has any reason to have confidence in the flesh, that is, what we can accomplish by our own effort, if anyone has reason to be confident, to be able to do what is good by their own efforts and to not do what is not good by their own efforts, there's anyone who thinks they have reason to be confident about themselves about this point. I should be much more able to say that than they do. And in verses 5 and 6, Paul has a laundry list of his reasons for being, if he wanted to do this, to be confident about his credentials, about what he brings to the table that could and should be honored. And so we won't spend a lot of time on this, but here's Paul's laundry list about this. The first is about honor that's ascribed to Paul by the work of others or what others have done. Here's what he says. That his citizenship is right, that his birth is right. He was circumcised on the eighth day. His parents did what they were supposed to do. He's of the people of Israel, who are God's people. He is of the tribe of Benjamin, who hold a particular place of honor in the spectrum of the tribes of Judah of Israel, because it was the only tribe who stayed and kept their allegiance with Judah as opposed to going with the other 10 tribes. And because of that, were held in high esteem because of the good people that they were. And Paul says, I am a Hebrew of Hebrews. If there's anybody that ought to be a poster child for being a good Hebrew, I'm the one. I was born right. My parents did the right things for me and to me and with me. I have the right ancestry. But his list doesn't end there. He goes on and talks about some things he's done that also ought to get him on a list like this. He's a Pharisee, he says, so he's joined the right party, the people who work the hardest at being right and good people. He has the right of party affiliation, in other words. He has the right education because they were in the business of teaching the law. They wanted deeply to obey the law. He went to the right college, he could say. He joined the right party. He knew the right folks, and he got the right degree. And besides that, he said, when it comes to my ambition or my zealousness, I was so patriotic to my people that I persecuted the church. He wasn't hanging his head at this moment. He might have been. But for his purposes for this moment, he wasn't hanging his head as he does in other places. And so for the people who knew the story, and for those of us who know the story today, we know that Paul, at Paul's hand, the first Christian martyr, lost his life, Stephen. Paul oversaw that operation. So, he was of the right party, the right education, the right degree. He was as patriotic could be. He killed in the name of his religion. And he kept the law perfectly, without blemish, he says. I don't know what this would sound like in our contemporary culture. I have some ideas, but I think what he could say, what he would be saying if he was saying, go ahead, look me up on Google if you want to. Look me up on Facebook and find out what you can find about on Twitter about me. You're not going to be able to dig up. You can look into my legal background all you want to. You can get any lawyer you want to and look into it. You go ahead, do it. You're never going to find a speeding ticket. You're never going to find that I have a traffic ticket, even a traffic ticket in my background. Anybody here want to brag like that? Just raise your hand. I'm just saying I can't. You will find no one, Paul would be saying. You will find no one who can make an accusation against me because there's nothing wrong. I did it all. And now Paul says in verse 7, he sets all of this stuff about things that he could brag about, all of these things that in which he could put his confidence in what he did. And he measures all that stuff carefully. He takes stock of it. We have to be careful here now as Christians, particularly talking about the way he adhered to his Jewish faith. Paul doesn't pitch it on its own merit under the bus as he does it. He doesn't say what he's going to say just to say it was all worthless. It's not quite what he says here. It wouldn't fit into Paul's theology and what else he says in other places to say it that way. What he does say is this: if I look at it all those things, that laundry list I just gave you, if I set it all out there and I compared it to knowing Christ, then it is, comparatively speaking, just rubbish. That's all it is. I'm far enough away from home today that I have to explain this. If I were in the congregation I usually worship with on Sunday morning, the Zion Mennonite Church in Archbold, Ohio, there wouldn't be any explanation necessary. Everybody would just know about this. If you were to drive there, Archbold, Ohio, northwest corner of Ohio, and you were to just drive around in the countryside, here is what you would see. You would notice that everything is absolutely neat and tidy. The farmsteads, the houses, the buildings, there is nothing out of place. The farmers mow their ditch banks in Archbold, Ohio. Now, I'm not talking about just once or twice a year going out with a tractor and a bush hog and just taking it down. No, I'm talking about like the mower, and twice a week they mow their ditch banks. Any of you, I don't want to step on anybody's toes. Any of you mow your ditches twice a week here? Just wondering about that. It's pretty serious there. Now, so if you're in that community, you just see miles, or in the countryside, miles of ditch banks that are mowed. Everything has purpose and order. It's clear. To have status and standing in Archbold, this neat and tidy and orderly and beautiful part of the world, that's the way you have to be. And on the other hand, which is, in my case, the Michigan hand, so it's, if you go from the border, the border is a political boundary that's drawn up by somebody somewhere. But the difference in the culture is readily apparent. Ohio into Michigan, where I live. Where I live, people don't mow their ditch banks. Where I live, no one worries about having a green lawn because we have lawn ornaments aplenty where we are. If neat and tidy are the status symbols in Ohio, cars and trucks and boats and campers in all stages of disrepair are the status symbols of my people. A car that is on four tires, that has air in it, and actually runs when you want it to run is a good thing, but an even better thing is if you have a couple spares that are up on blocks and the doors are open and they're there for parts. The more junk cars, the better where I live. If you want to have status in the community where I live, that's the way you are. Now, I don't know what happened at our house, but one day, my son mowed the ditch banks of we have 32 acres and we have some ditch banks, and he mowed the ditch banks. He took just one run at it, you know, each side of the road. Actually, he just stayed on our side, I think, yeah. Just took one run at it. Well, pretty soon, my son's dad started to mow the ditch banks too. And he apparently wasn't satisfied with mowing his own ditch banks. Something got into him. I don't know what. It's hard to describe. But he also mowed across the road the neighbor's ditch banks on the other side of the road. And he mowed down to on that property a little bit and that property a little bit. And he started to mow the neighbor's ditch banks because he's disabled and he can't mow. And so Ditch Banks for that, neighbors. And all of a sudden, all I know to say is that the 2 miles of road that my kid's dad live on, all of a sudden, everybody was mowing their ditch banks. It was a startling experience. And the key for our purposes this morning here is that all of those beautiful cars in the yards, like when you see them through a different set of eyes, they're just junk. That's all they are. They're just rubbish. Compared to the delight of knowing beautiful yards with beautiful lawns and clean yards, all of that stuff is just rubbish. And Paul is saying that somehow, he doesn't name it, but on the road to Damascus that day, he got reoriented most severely about what was important in life. And the things that seemed so good now, compared with knowing Christ who met him on that road, it just looked like trash to him now. One mark, first mark of the making of a pastor is, in Paul's words, that they've let go of their reliance on themselves, their own capacity, and their own strength. Second mark of a pastor looking over Paul's shoulders. Paul didn't just lose something. He chose to lose it. Paul didn't just lose something, but he gained something that was really, really important for him. In verse 8b, the last half of verse 8, he says, all of that stuff that I was talking about was just rubbish compared with the greatness of knowing Jesus Christ, of being found in him, Paul says. Verse 10, Paul has just, I think, a really neat kind of a literary trick for those of us who are standing on this side of the cross and of Easter. He starts with knowing Christ, and what he says is, I want, this is what I want, instead of what I used to want, to be perfect by my own efforts. Now what I want is to know Christ. I want to know the power of his resurrection. We celebrate it in just a couple of weeks. I want to know the fellowship of his suffering. He starts backwards with the knowing Christ, and then backwards to the resurrection, then backwards to the fellowship of his suffering, and even his death. You have to hear Paul writing from a prison cell, knowing that his life was probably coming to an end at that time. And he said, that's what I really want, to learn to know Christ. And the power of his resurrection and his suffering, and even to become like him in his death. And then the key to this part of it, the passage, is there's a new focus. To somehow, as I do that, I attain the resurrection from the dead. To know and to be known, Paul says. In a little bit he'll say to find, but also to be found. I was studying this passage again this week. I just had this vivid memory of a teacher who taught about, wasn't teaching about this, but it lines up, I think, really well with this. It was a remarkable thing. Dallas Willard was his name. He's a theologian. Some of you may have had opportunity to write. He's written a lot of pretty influential stuff in the last 20 years. And I was in a class in which he was talking about the value of practicing the spiritual disciplines, putting ourselves in a place where the Spirit can do the Spirit's work in us. And what he said when he said that was, here's what you will find happens. If you let yourself intentionally be in that place where the Spirit can do the work, what you're going to find is that someday when you meet Christ face to face, it's not going to be a totally new experience, because you will discover that Christ has already been at work shaping you into Christ so that when you see Christ face to face, you will recognize the familiarity of what Christ has been doing in your life already. Incredible statement to me. I think that's what Paul is driving at here. The second mark of a new making of a pastor is that they have a new focus, to know and to be known by Christ. Not by my own doing, but by the work Christ is doing in me. The third mark of a pastor from this passage, verse 12. Paul is really clear. This stuff may be going on in my life, but it is not finished yet. God is, in simple words, God is just not finished yet. I have not yet been made to be perfect, Paul says. He's really clear about that. Instead, I press on to take hold of that for which Christ took hold of me. I love that line. One of my favorite old hymns has this, I sought the Lord. It's the song. And it's the first line of the first verse. This is it. I sought the Lord, and afterward I knew he moved my soul to seek him, seeking me. It was not so much that I took hold on thee, that I on thee took hold, as thou, dear Lord, on me. Paul uses words of competition here, as he often does. He uses this word press on, which is a term that comes from people who run races. It's what you do when you're in the race and you're pushing on toward the end. I haven't achieved the end of all of this yet, but my job now is to push on and to do it with a singular focus. And though I'm not finished, I'm getting there. And then he says, part of what's involved with that is to forget what is behind me. Paul has some things behind him that aren't altogether glorious, and he's already named them. I don't know what it would be like living with having taken someone's life who was a Christian, and then later needing to be in fellowship with Christians. That kind of zealousness to live with what I did. But Paul says, I choose not to stay back there, but to press on to win the prize, to cross at the finish line. The third mark of a pastor that's being made is that they know they're not finished yet. God is still at work. It's our job now to press on. So just to backtrack for a moment and then come to the passage we started with. Pastors maturing, growing, need to have the capacity to let go of their reliance on themselves, to get reoriented toward Christ as the center, and to know that God's still in the business of shaping them. They're not finished yet. And now we're back to where we started. And so then we can hear Paul say, join with others in following my example. I have been a witness, I think Paul would say, to the work of Christ in my life. I have been a witness personally to the work of Christ in Jared's life in the years that I've known him. I find it to be quite remarkable and commendable. Part of why it's commendable is because Jared isn't driving the car. He's allowing the car to be driven for him. I admonish you as a congregation to join with others in following Jared's example. Not because Jared is perfect. Jared's not God. Jared's never going to be God. And that's good. Thank you. But as he keeps putting himself in the place where Jesus can, he keeps putting himself in that place where God's work can and will be done. As he keeps pointing himself toward Jesus, and the work that he does keeps pointing toward Jesus, it will be good for Jared to say, "Follow me." But the second part is, "As I follow Jesus." May God's blessings rest on you richly, Jared. And may God's blessing rest richly on you as a congregation as you respond to Jesus' call to follow.
Another choice by Jared. In the blue book, the worship book, please turn to number 546. Number 546 in the blue book, "Guide My Feet." Let's all stand.
Guide my feet while I run this race. Yes, my Lord, guide my feet while I run this race. Yes, my Lord, guide my feet while I run this race. For I don't want to run this race in race, for I don't want to run this race in vain. Stand by me while I run this race. Yes, my Lord, stand by me while I run this race. Yes, my Lord, stand by me while I run this race, for I don't want to run this race in vain. I'm your child while I run this race. Yes, my Lord, I'm your child while I run this race. Yes, my Lord, I'm your child while I run this race. For I don't want to run this race in vain. Search my heart while I run this race. Yes, my Lord, search my heart while I run this race. Yes, my Lord, search my heart while I run this race. For I don't want to run this race in vain. Guide my feet while I run this race. Yes, my Lord, guide my feet while I run this race. Yes, my Lord, sir, guide my feet while I run this race. For I don't want want to run this race in vain, race in vain.
At the benedictory, we will be singing from the Mennonite hymnal, number 504, God Be With You, verses 1 and 2. So keep that in mind. Number 504, Mennonite hymnal.
Now for the benediction, I invite you to rise. I invite you to the foyer for a celebration. I would love to talk and interact with each and every one of you. And hear these words. Jesus Christ has made you his own. Go forth forgetting what is behind and moving ahead to the heavenly call of God in Christ Jesus.